Today we're taking a look at Psalm 4, and this is another psalm with a title. Again, I want to remind you that the titles to the psalms, that's what appears before verse 1, is in the Hebrew text of the psalm. It's not something that the translators added. So the title of this psalm is, To the Chief Musician with Stringed Instruments, a Psalm of David. That's a very interesting title because, first of all, it tells us who the psalm was directed towards, the chief musician. Now, this is a very interesting title that's given in many of the psalms. Many of the psalms in their title are addressed to the chief musician. Some people suppose that the chief musician was the leader of the choirs, such as somebody as Heman the singer or Asaph. You'll find that in 1 Chronicles chapter 6 and in chapter 16. But it may very well be that when David wrote a psalm like this and attributed it to the chief musician, he had in mind God himself. Is not God the chief musician? Is not God the one who invented music and the one who's the greater musician than anyone else? So it's a little hard to tell whether or not David is directing this to the leader of the choirs or the worship leader for the kingdom of Israel, or whether it's the Lord itself, but it's to the chief musician. It was to be played upon stringed instruments. And of course, it is a Psalm of David. Now, we just take that phrase with stringed instruments to remind ourselves that these psalms were and are today songs. They were intended to be sung. And in this song, David is going to pour out his complaint against slanderous enemies, and he's going to find his peace and refuge in God. Okay, you ready with that? That beginning, that kind of preview now to Psalm 4, let's get into the first verse of the psalm where we read this. David is talking to God and he says, Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. You have relieved me in my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. You know what I love about David's calling out to God in verse 1 is that there's passion in David's cry. He says, Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. David isn't just sort of casting up words towards heaven. Sometimes we pray kind of mechanically without much passion. No, David needed God's attention to his present problem, and so he prayed with great passion. I would have to say that oftentimes we lack power in our prayer because there's little passion in our prayer. Now, I want to be very careful about this. We don't persuade God by our emotional displays. That's kind of the thinking that the prophets of Baal had on Mount Carmel when Elijah confronted the prophets on Mount Carmel in the book of 1 Kings. It was the prophets of Baal who were screaming and crying out and cutting themselves, extremely emotional displays, but because they were praying to a non-entity, nothing happened. Now, Elijah prayed very simply, but yet he prayed, I would say, passionately, sincerely from the heart. So we don't persuade God by our emotional displays, but God wants us to care deeply about the things that he cares deeply about. And so we need to have an appropriate passion in our prayers. I'm not talking about something that's worked up in the energy of the flesh, but hopefully a spirit-led and inspired passion. The prophet Isaiah spoke with sorrow about the lack of this kind of passion in Israel. Let me read to you Isaiah chapter 64, verse 7. It says this, And there is no one who calls on your name who stirs himself up to take hold of you. That idea of stirring himself up to take hold of God, that's saying, Lord, I want to have passion and prayer and in an appropriate way, again, not in a grotesque, artificial way, but in an appropriate way, we could say that David stirred himself up to take hold of God here when he cried out, Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. And by the way, don't you love that phrase? O God of my righteousness. David knew that his righteousness came from God. It didn't come from himself. David called upon the God who made him righteous. Listen, that's something that you and I, as believers in Jesus Christ, can pray. We can call out to God because truly he is the God of our righteousness. Then David says, "You have relieved me. Have mercy on me. You have relieved me in my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer." Now, that's a very familiar pattern that David reflects there in verse 1. Again, calling out to God with passion, calling out to the God of his righteousness, and then saying, "You have relieved me in my distress. Have mercy on me now and hear my prayer." This is a familiar pattern, David using God's past mercies as a ground for God's future help. It's as if David prayed something like this: "God, I know that you have blessed me in the past. I believe you'll bless me in the present. God, I know that in the past you blessed me and you didn't do it just to abandon me now. So have mercy on me." Brothers and sisters, it is a very effective and wonderful thing for us in prayer to bring before God his past mercies to us as a reason for his present favor towards us. Think of all the times, all the situations that God has been good and faithful to you in the past. Bring those before God and say, "Lord, I know you've been faithful to me in the past. I believe you want to be faithful to me in the present and into the future." So, verse 1 is David crying out to God. Now in verses 2 and 3, David is going to talk to men. He's going to talk to the people who have been troubling him. Check this out, verses 2 and 3. He says this: "How long, O you sons of men, will you turn my glory to shame? How long will you love worthlessness and seek falsehood, Selah? But know that the Lord has set apart for himself him who is godly. The Lord will hear when I call to him." I love these words of David to the men who were troubling him. He speaks to those who were slandering his name, who were his enemies, and he asks them a very valid question. He says, did you see it there in verse 2? How long? How long are you going to keep your ungodly way? Look, you can't keep it up forever. It's going to come to an end. Whether it comes to an end because you repent and decide to bring it to an end, or whether it comes to an end because God just stops you in your track, it will not last forever. So you may as well abandon it now and come under the blessing of God. That is a very provocative question for everybody who finds themselves in a compromising or in an evil path. How long are you going to walk it? There you are. You're in a compromised place. You're walking on a compromising course. How long are you going to do it? If you extend this course of action that you're on out to its logical and inevitable conclusion, where are you going to be? Now, knowing that, how long are you going to play around with this sin? How long? That's what David is asking these men. How long will you turn my glory to shame? In other words, we're going to see this throughout the psalm, that much of the problem that David seemed to face from these enemies was that they were slandering his name. They were seeking to turn his glory to shame. God was using David. God was doing great things in and through David. But they took occasion of these areas where God was using him, and in some way, they tried to turn David's glory to shame. And David just says, how long are you going to continue to do it? Now, there are many people who try to connect Psalm 4 with the previous psalm, Psalm 3. Psalm 3 comes from the time when David's son Absalom rebelled against him, and it's a wonderful psalm. But the connection that some people make between Psalm 4 and Psalm 3, I don't think that I agree with it. Let me tell you why. Because the focus in Psalm 4 isn't really on David's physical safety or on the preservation of his kingdom. Psalm 4 seems to be about the preservation of David's reputation. Wicked men were slandering David. They were lying about him. And so it doesn't seem like it's the same situation. But David was being opposed nevertheless. So he asks, how long, O you, O sons of men, will you turn my glory to shame? Just one thought before we go on to verse 3. I want you to consider that Jesus experienced what David experienced, except Jesus experienced it far more. Wicked men tried to turn almost every glorious thing in the ministry of Jesus into some kind of shame. Jesus shows remarkable love and grace towards sinful people, and people say, oh, he's the friend of sinners. Jesus is there in the midst of people, loving them, eating at the table there with people who need help. And people mocked him. People said that Jesus was a drunkard. People accused him of all kinds of things. They tried to turn the glory of Jesus into shame. Wicked men, as I said, they tried to turn almost every glorious thing in the ministry of Jesus into shame, but it wouldn't happen. All right, now, verse 3, David here says, but know that the Lord has set apart for himself him who is godly. David knew that he and other godly people were set apart for God. Now, isn't that a wonderful thought? The Lord has set apart for himself him who is godly. Brothers and sisters, I hope that's you. I hope that's me. Now, in Jesus Christ, we can say that there's a very real sense in when that's true of all of us. God has set us apart. And there are many reasons why we set things apart. Sometimes we set things apart for our own enjoyment. I want to use that tennis racket, and I don't want anybody else to use it because I really enjoy using that tennis racket. And so we could say, I set that apart for my own enjoyment. Sometimes we set things apart for greater purity. Something is isolated or put into a room where it can't be contaminated in any way. It's set apart for greater purity. Sometimes we set things apart for special service. There's a tool or a serving dish that somebody uses, and they want to use it in a very special way. It's for special service. Now, for all of those reasons and more, God sets us apart to himself. You are set apart for God's own enjoyment. You are set apart for greater purity unto the Lord. And I would say this, you are set apart for God's special service. David understood this. The Lord has set apart for himself him who is godly. And then he continues on in verse 3. The Lord will hear when I call to him. The ungodly have disaster waiting for them, but the godly have a great reward in the Lord. That's why David knows the Lord will hear when I call to him. I believe that God wants every single Christian to have that same assurance today. Every Christian should be confident that God will hear their prayers. Now, it is true that there are times, maybe even seasons in our life, when prayer seems ineffective. And let me say something. If you feel that God is not hearing when you call to him, you need to analyze this. Number one, you need to simply ask, maybe God's answering, but he's just not answering the way you want. May I say that yes is an answer to prayer, no is an answer to prayer, and wait is an answer to prayer. Oftentimes, the only answer we want to hear from God is yes, and right away, yes. But we need to understand, if God answers your prayer with no, that's an answer. If God answers your prayer with wait, that's an answer. But I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about the yes, no, wait. I'm talking about sometimes when we feel there is no answer to our prayer at all. Did you know that the Bible tells us that there are several reasons why prayer may not be answered? And I kind of think of this as that when our prayers are not answered, it should give us an opportunity to do a little bit of spiritual inventory. In other words, in John chapter 15, verse 7, Jesus said that if we abide in him, our prayers will be answered. Well, listen, maybe your prayer isn't being answered because you're not abiding in Jesus. In Matthew chapter 17, verses 20 and 21, Jesus indicates that unbelief is a reason for unanswered prayer. Maybe your prayer isn't being answered because you don't believe. Maybe, and this is also in Matthew chapter 17, verse 21, your prayer isn't answered because you're not fasting. Jesus indicated that some answers to prayer come when we fast, that is, we abstain from food and drink only water. Here's another one, one that might surprise you. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7 says that a bad marriage relationship may hinder your prayers. Could that not be a reason? Now listen, I'm not here to tell you, oh, I know this is why your prayer isn't being answered. I'm just saying that the Bible gives several reasons why prayer may not be answered. Not abiding in Jesus, unbelief, a failure to fast, a bad marriage relationship. Here's another one, unconfessed sin. James chapter 5, verse 16 says that unconfessed sin may hinder our prayers. Psalm 17, verse 1 says that lying and deceitfulness may hinder our prayers. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 9 says that a lack of Bible reading and Bible teaching may be a hindrance to our prayers. Again, I just want you to know that sometimes unanswered prayer is like a warning signal to us. There's something not right in your relationship with God, and God is trying to draw attention to that, and that's why he's saying, I'm not going to answer that prayer until you answer this thing and get this worked out in your life. Now again, from this distance, from this distance I have to your particular life, I can't tell you that I know any of these reasons. You got to talk to the Holy Spirit about this. First of all, again, understand this. God may answer a prayer, yes, no, or wait. But when we feel that we have no answer to our prayer, it may be a reason found in there's something not right in our walk before God that God wants us to give attention to. All right, so in verse 1, we saw that David talked to God. In verses 2 and 3, we saw that David talked to the men who were troubling him. Now, this is what I like. In verses 4 and following in the psalm, David will talk to himself. And you know, there's times when we need to talk to ourselves, don't we? Don't we need to tell ourselves the truth and let us know what's going on? So here in verses 4 and 5, David is going to talk to himself. He begins by saying, "Be angry and do not sin. Meditate within your heart on your bed and be still, Selah. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord." Now check this out. Verse 4, David says, "Be angry and do not sin." By the way, that's a verse quoted later on in the New Testament. But David is just simply recognizing this. With the ungodliness around him, David had reason to be angry, but he had no reason to sin. So he reminds himself to not sin in the midst of his anger, and instead to find solace and comfort in meditation before the Lord. That's why he says in verse 4, meditate within your heart. David spoke of the biblical practice of meditation. Now, this is not the Eastern practice of meditation. In the biblical practice of meditation, we fill our heart and mind with God's word. In Eastern meditation, the idea is to empty the heart and the mind. Listen, it can leave it open for anything, even leave it open for deceiving spirits. But no, in the biblical practice of meditation, we think deeply upon God's word. We pray through what God says in his scriptures. We think about the words. We think about the context. We think about the phrasing. We think deeply and sort of chew upon God's word again and again and again. So instead of being angry in a sinful way, meditate within your heart on your bed and be still. Calm down. Think about it. And then David says, speaking to himself, offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. Now, David knew the value of religious observance, offering the sacrifices. That's sort of like we might make it analogous today to going to church or something like that. But David also knew that religious observance, such as offering sacrifices in his own day, David knew that that could not replace trusting in the Lord. In other words, brothers, sisters, you may go to church. You may go to church every week. You may go to church a couple of times a week. God bless you for that. But you still need to put your trust in the Lord. It's possible to observe religious practices without actually putting your trust in the Lord. Now, when religious observance is combined with a true trust in God, we draw near to God and we experience the benefits of drawing near to Him. Now, again, I love this. This is David speaking to himself. He's telling himself, David, be angry, but don't sin. David, meditate within your heart on your bed. Calm down, be still. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness. Yes, bring that lamb or goat or bull before God, but put your trust in the Lord. And then he continues to speak to himself here, starting at verse 6. Let's read verse 6 through the end of the psalm where it says this. There are many who say, who will show us any good? Lord, lift up the light of your countenance upon us. You have put gladness in my heart more than in the season that their grain and wine increased. I will both lie down in peace and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. What a beautiful conclusion to the psalm. And let's kind of take it apart phrase by phrase here. In verse 6, David is recounting the words of many who say, who will show us any good? You see, the voice of an ungodly cynic was echoing in David's ear. It says, who's going to show us any good? Hasn't God given up on us? Why would God want to continue to bless us? You see, after being continually disappointed by other people, one can begin to doubt if God will show us any good. But David responds with confidence. Even though there were many people saying, nope, God's done showing us good, David responds with a great confidence in the second line of verse 6, where he says, Lord, lift up the light of your countenance upon us. Despite whatever any of the cynics might say, despite what any of the cynics might think, David trusted that the Lord would show him good. And what was the good that God was going to show upon him? Lifting up the light of his countenance upon us. Now, what does that mean? Well, you know what a countenance is, don't you? It's the face. The light of God's face. It's as if God will look upon us and his face will beam with favor and goodness towards us. Look, you know what it is to look upon somebody's face when they are very angry with you, to look upon somebody's face when they are very disappointed with you. That's not a pleasant experience, is it? You know, we kind of conjure back in our minds. We think back, oh man, I remember my father's face or my mother's face when I disappointed them in this way. Man, their face. I remember my teacher's face when I made my teacher angry. It's just that's not a good vision. But David says, no, God will lift up the light of his countenance upon us. Despite what any of the cynics might say, despite what any of the cynics might think when they say in verse 6, who will show us any good? David trusted that the Lord would show him good. David claimed this upon the ironic promise of blessing in Numbers chapter 6. Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26, God commanded the priests to give this blessing over the people of Israel. I love this. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Isn't that a beautiful blessing? That's the blessing that the priests of Israel were to pronounce over the people of Israel. Now, there's even greater blessing for the child of God under the new covenant, but that's still a good blessing. And David says, I know that this promised priestly blessing will be upon me. The Lord will lift up the light of his countenance upon us. And David says, verse 7, you've put gladness in my heart. When we know that the face of God shines favorably upon us, it puts gladness in our heart. Even though David was in distress, even though he was troubled by ungodly men all around him, he could still have gladness in his heart because the Lord put it there. Matter of fact, when we connect this with the second phrase of verse 7, it's even more powerful. David says there in verse 7, more than in the season that their grain and wine increased. Do you understand what David's saying there? Let me read the entire verse 7 to you, just so you got it. He says, you have put gladness in my heart more than in the season that their grain and wine increased. Now, David is speaking of the increase of grain and wine on behalf of the ungodly people who were slandering him, lying about him. And he says, God, you've put gladness in my heart greater than the gladness that the ungodly have when they're prospering. Now listen, the ungodly get pretty happy when they're making a lot of money, when their grain and wine increase, when everything is thriving. The ungodly usually can be pretty happy. David says, God, you have given me a gladness that's even greater than that. You know, and I would say this, oftentimes the ungodly can only be happy when the money is pouring in and everything is prosperous. David could be happy even in distressing times because the Lord put this gladness in his heart. I love that phrase in verse 7. You have put gladness in my heart. Listen, instead of trying to chase around happiness and achieve happiness, well, why don't you instead just look to the Lord and ask God to pour out his gladness into your heart? Make that your prayer. God, I want to be able to say this with David. You have put gladness in my heart. I want to claim this for myself as well. And I want it more than the gladness that the ungodly have when they're prospering financially. Now, verse 8 is a beautiful, poetic end to this psalm. Look at verse 8. David says this, I will both lie down in peace and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safely. Safety. Now, David could sleep well at night, even in stressful and distressing times. Even when he was surrounded by the ungodly, he could go to sleep just fine because his safety was from the Lord, not from circumstances or not even from feelings. I think back to the book of Acts, where Peter was arrested and put in prison, and it looked like Peter might be executed. And God sent an angel to free Peter from prison. And when the angel came to the prison cell that Peter was being held in, where did he find Peter? He found Peter asleep. There he is sleeping. You might say, Peter, how can you sleep? You might be executed the next day. Aren't you laying awake at night in worry, in stress, and fear? Peter says, no, I'm going to quote David's heart in Psalm 4, verse 8, where he says, I will both lie down in peace and sleep. Now, you can just imagine that man, can't you? Lying down to sleep, but he can't sleep. He's tormented by what his enemies or by what his pretended friends say about him. This may be you. Maybe you think about what other people say about you, what they think about you, and it bothers you so much that you can't sleep at night. Now, potentially, David, in this psalm, could have been that man, but instead, he trusted in the Lord, and he had a gladness in his heart that the world couldn't take away, even with all of their slanders, all of their lies. We need to receive from God what David received from God. We need to be able to say that, Lord, you will lift up the light of your countenance upon us, and you have put gladness in my heart. And then he concludes the psalm again, the vast phrase here of verse 8. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. I found a very interesting understanding of this phrase from G. Campbell Morgan. And again, I'm not a Hebrew scholar, so I can't judge how well G. Campbell Morgan is reflecting the sense of this verse. But, you know, when we first read it, you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety, we think, okay, God and God alone makes me dwell in safety. I get that. And that's a true statement. Isn't it? Nobody else makes us dwell in safety. Only the Lord does. But G. Campbell Morgan pointed out the idea there was not that the Lord and none other makes us dwell in safety. Instead, G. Campbell Morgan says that the Hebrew here presents the idea that David found safety in solitude with God. Let me read you this quote from G. Campbell Morgan. He says this, quote, "The thought of the word alone is in loneliness, or as Rotherham renders it, in seclusion. And the word refers to the one going asleep. This is a glorious conception of sleep. Jehovah gathers the trusting soul into a place of safety by taking it away from all the things which trouble or harass. The tried and tired child of his love is secure in his peace." Now, again, I like that idea. I can't say positively that I know G. Campbell Morgan was correct in this understanding of it, but the simple idea is that David was finding safety in solitude with God. Lord, I thank you for the community of people that you put around me, but sometimes my only safety is in solitude with you. I receive that solitude. Maybe that's a word to you, dear brother or sister. Maybe, and again, you thank God for the community of believers that he's put around you. Nevertheless, it's important to say, it's important to know that we find our safety alone in God. Now, let's conclude with this thought. Where do we see Jesus in this psalm? Well, we see Jesus in several places. We noted before in verse 2 that Jesus was the ultimate example of the one whom wicked men tried to turn his glory into shame. And again, so we see Jesus there. We also see Jesus in this wonderful place that Jesus fulfills our confidence that the Lord will hear us when we call. Did you see that in verse 3? Where it says, the Lord will hear when I called him. Now, David had confidence for saying that. I want to say, believer, you have even greater confidence for hearing that in Jesus Christ, because Jesus gives you the promise that God will hear you when you call upon him in Jesus' name. We also could say in verse 4 that Jesus was the ultimate example of being angry and not sinning. You see Jesus there angry on the Temple Mount, turning over the tables of the money changers and the merchants. He was angry, but he did not sin. I find it interesting that my efforts to be angry and to not sin are almost always corrupted in some way or another. But Jesus, he was the ultimate expression of being angry but not sinning. And then finally, I would say this, Jesus is the ultimate expression of the light of God's countenance. Brother, sister, how can you know that God looks upon you with a pleasant face, with a smile on his face? You can know it because of what God has done for you in Jesus Christ. You stand in God's grace because of what God has done for you in Jesus Christ. If you've put your trust in Jesus Christ, if you've been made right with God on the basis of putting your trust and love in him, you've repented of your sins, you put your faith in Jesus Christ, then you are right with God and you are in the grace of God. The light of God's countenance in Jesus Christ shines upon you. Again, we see so many of the things that David had confidence for in this psalm. We have so much more reason to be confident because of who Jesus is and what he has done for us, especially what he did for us at the cross and the empty tomb. Psalm 4 is a beautiful psalm. I want to conclude our time with it here with a simple prayer for you. So let me do that. Father in heaven, I pray for everyone who views this or listens to this. And I pray that you would give them the rest and the security in you, even when they are being slandered by enemies. I pray, Lord, that you would give them the understanding of the shining light of your countenance, even when others say that there is no good for them in God or anywhere else. Thank you for all you've given us in Jesus Christ. Thank you for the reasons for answered prayer. Thank you for the assurance of your favor. Thank you for the gift of your sleep. We receive it, Lord, with gratitude in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen.